Assalamualaikum baik.
Salam.
Inshallah, we're going to begin. And I know that all of you know Brother Nouman, so I don't need to introduce him. He was here to talk about jihad last year, just a bit of it. And today he's going to be talking about young Sahaba. And then he's going to be talking about them, their lives, what they did, you know, whatever he has been sharing, and then relating it to our lives, you know, as young Muslims today. So, without further ado, Brother Nouman.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود ذلك مثلهم في التوراة ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار وعد الله الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات منهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. أما بعد، اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله. أمين يا رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Inshallah, I'd like to share with you a few sections of the Quran, and instead of sharing with you detailed accounts of a number of Sahaba, I'll share with you the accounts of one particular Sahabi that we can draw specific lessons from, inshallah. But before I do, I'd like to share with you another type of sahabi, a different type of companion. Not one that's a role model, but that one that you would look down upon. We find in the Quran another messenger mentioned and his companions mentioned in detail. And the amazing thing is, because these are people that have passed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to the sons of Israel at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he speaks to them in second person. Okay, وَذْكُرُوا and, you know, نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ, right? إِذْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مُوسَى بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ when Musa came upon you. Now notice, he didn't come on them. Who did he come on? He came on their forefathers. But he speaks of them in the second person only to make it highlighted, just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to those who have iman. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا is also in second person. All those of you who believe. So all of those ayat you find in second person, particularly in Surah Baqarah. And so I'd like to begin with the negative and move towards the positive, inshallah ta'ala. For all of us, we have not seen Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And for the Sahaba that were seeing him, they had not seen Allah. They had not seen miracles from the sky or anything supernatural, save a few of them who saw some particular incidents that we can pinpoint. But for these specific companions of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, imagine this, you're about to be executed by a tyrant ruler. You're lost in the desert with this man who promises that he can save you. And you're crying to him saying, you lied to us. Here's the army, it's coming upon us to destroy us. And you brought us in the middle of this desert to be slaughtered like sheep. And he strikes his staff and a body of water parts and you walk right through it. If you were an atheist before, or if you were just tagging along for the ride before thinking, hey, maybe he's right, maybe he's wrong, I'll take my chances. If I stay in Egypt, then I'm for sure I'll be slaughtered. So notice in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say, وَلَن نُؤْمِنَ بِكَ. The Bani Israel don't say, we're not going to believe you. They say, وَلَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ. نُؤْمِنُ بِي and نُؤْمِنَ لَهُ. Big difference. Nu'minu bi is to believe in, to confirm that he brought the truth. Nu'minu la, that in the Arabic terminology refers to accept. We'll go along with what you're saying. The same thing Fir'aun said to Musa alayhi salam. He said, I'm not going to let them go. And he said, وَلَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ, the chiefs of Fir'aun said, we're not going to let accept what you're saying. Your demands are to let these people go. We're not going to accept what you're saying. Their statement wasn't, we're not going to believe in you. That they had already given as a statement before. We're not going to believe in you no matter what. So the point was now to accept what he's saying, to follow him. So among the Bani Israel, there are those who might have been in doubt. Maybe this guy's crazy. Maybe he's right. Maybe he's wrong. Why not take our chances? Because for sure we're going to die here. They go, they see a body of water part. They pass right through it. And that Fir'aun, who they saw people make sajda to, that Fir'aun that armies used to crumble before him, they saw him perish before their own eyes. So if nothing else made you believe in Allah before that, and if it didn't make you take Musa alayhi salam seriously before that, I would think this incident would open your eyes. Right? This is a pretty big thing to watch, to see a body of water just open up. Now you're in the middle of the desert, and the first thing that human beings will suffer in the desert is dehydration. So wherever you're traveling with Musa, وَظَلَّلْنَا عَلَيْكُمُ الْغَمَامِ, and we shaded upon you a cloud, the cloud. This al-ghamam used to follow them wherever they went. Now imagine that, you're in the desert, you're stranded, you're going to dehydrate out of the heat, but there's a cloud following you, offering you shade and offering you water. وَأَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَنَّ وَالسَّلْوَى. Now in the desert, first of all, to have plantation that you can get bread out of is next to impossible. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends man. Then he sends salwa upon them. And man came through rain, which is miraculous in and of itself. But salwa, the natural instinct for any bird, if you try to catch it, is to do what? Just to fly off. But these salwa, they used to come, they're described in most of the tafsir as the likes of quails. They would come in herds. They would come in packs. And they would just sit there at night waiting for themselves to be caught. Free food, literally. وَظَلَّلْنَا عَلَيْكُمُ الْغَمَامِ, free shading, free covering, lodging, right? And now, manna and salwa. And then Allah says, كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ, go eat freely what we have provided you. Go ahead, eat, enjoy. Not only did we save you from someone you had no chance of saving yourselves, not only did we bring you out of the darkness of shirk, whatever misguidance you were in, we brought you a messenger who has guidance with him, now you get all this free stuff. So if you weren't a believer before then, you would think, hey, okay, you've seen a lot of stuff now. You would really believe. Let's top it all off. Now Musa leaves you for a little while and you get tricked by somebody. Let's give them benefit of the doubt. Somebody makes a statue of a golden calf and he makes passages through it so when the wind blows, it makes a sound. So people, and he convinces them that this is God and they start worshiping it. So when Musa alayhi salam comes back, he gets angry at Harun. You all know the story, right? Alayhi salam, he gets angry at Harun alayhi salam and says, what did you do in my absence? So he says, I didn't have authority over them like you do. And the example that my teacher gave me in this regard in Surah A'raf, when this incident is mentioned in some detail, is, you know, you have a teacher in class. The teacher's keeping the class in control. Everybody's sitting in their seat, quiet, doing their work. He says, I'll be back in 5 minutes. And he puts a class monitor, some nerdy kid from the back of the class. You're in charge, 5 minutes, make sure nobody talks. As soon as he leaves, that nerdy kid's getting paper thrown at his face, people are chewing gum, people are yelling and screaming, some people are pulling his shirt, people do all kinds of things because he doesn't have the same authority as the teacher did, even though he was delegated authority by the teacher himself. Harun alayhi salam is also a prophet, but he's not a messenger, he's not a rasul like Musa alayhi salam. He doesn't have the authority of Musa alayhi salam. Another reason he doesn't have the authority of Musa alayhi salam is because Musa was brought up in the family, in the lineage of Fir'aun, so he knew how to control people. He had that legacy. But Harun alayhi salam was brought with the oppressed people. He was raised among them. So there's a big difference in the way of leadership between the two. But in any ways, he comes back. What's going on here? They refer the matter to Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed just in hint in the Quran. We find details in tafsir, but in the Quran we find very brief account, particularly in Surah Baqarah. Okay? وَإِذْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَالْفُرْقَانَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ, when we gave Musa the book and the criterion so that you can be guided. And the immediate next ayah is, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ إِنَّكُمْ ظَلَمْتُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ, O my qawm, you have done injustice against yourselves by taking the calf as something to worship. So make tawbah to your Rabb, فَتُوبُوا إِلَى بَارِئِكُمْ فَاقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, then kill yourselves. The ayah doesn't mean commit suicide, it means there are 12 tribes of Israel, for every tribe, the people that started worshiping the calf, if you're a Muslim and you do shirk, you left the state of Islam, so the punishment of murtad is execution, which is not something initiated in the law of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but it was actually started in the sharia of Musa alayhi wasallam. It's continued in the law of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now this command comes. Now notice, it's the same Musa who they saw with the permission of Allah parting a body of water, having a cloud follow them, manna and salwa, all of that good stuff. And they look at him in his face and they say, وَقَالُوا لَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ حَتَّى نَرَى اللَّهَ جَهْرًا. And they said, we're not going to believe in you until we see Allah face to face. You're telling us this? And it's not believe in you, I mistranslated. نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ, again. We're not going to accept what you're saying until we see Allah face to face. Then Allah says, فَأَخَذَتْكُمُ الصَّاعِقَةِ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ. Then an explosion, it seized you, and all of you died immediately. While you were watching before your eyes, an explosion came, it took them. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَوْتِكُمْ. Then He raised you from death. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So that now you can thank Allah. Now you can be like, okay, well, okay, fine, we'll do what you say. Right? But even then, there are so many other problems that are mentioned later on. So if you went through this, you got killed by Allah and He raised you back to life, you would think, now you would believe. You have no rational excuse to disbelieve or to sway in your belief. You'd be the best of believers because you've seen miracle after miracle after miracle. Last one I'll mention, because there's many more. Last one I'll mention. Allah mentions this 3 times in Surah Baqarah. In these 10 ruku', Allah mentions this one particularly 3 times because it's the craziest one. Like, it baffles your mind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَكُمْ وَرَفَعْنَا فَوْقَكُمُ الطُّورِ. When Allah took a covenant from you, and to make you realize how important these commandments are, this covenant, this law is, He raised the mountain of Tur in the air. So there's a mountain hovering in the air where you're standing below it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, hold on to what I have given you with all of your might. خُذُوا مَا أَتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةِ. 2 places. In one, in the exact same words, Allah says, وَذْكُرُوا مَا فِيهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Hold on to what I've given you with all of your might, and remember, remind yourselves of what's in it, so you can keep protecting yourselves, because once the mountain comes down, you're going to forget. So keep reminding yourselves, right? In that ayah in Surah Baqarah, the immediate next ayah is, ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ. Immediately then you turn back again. Immediately then you turn back again. How ironic. And in the other ayah, this is even more ironic, when the mountain is hovering above them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةِ وَاسْمَعُوا. And listen. قَالُوا. They said, سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. They said, we hear and we disobey. Imagine that. How crazy is that? There's a mountain hovering above you. Imagine somebody holding you at gunpoint. Much, much more subtle comparison. And asking you to do something. And you right in their face, if you really want to get shot in the head, you say, no. They're speaking to Allah directly saying, we hear and we disobey. But instead of crushing them under the mountain, Allah did something much, much, much worse. What did He do? وَأُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ الْعِجْلِ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ. Then He made their hearts drink the love of the calf. Then, though it's so irrational, illogical, it doesn't even make sense to worship a calf. It doesn't even make sense to disobey Musa. Their hearts were, the love of the calf, the worship of the calf was poured into their hearts. So no matter what their minds told them, their hearts were so diseased at that point, it couldn't help them. At the end of this detailed legacy of, you know, Bani Israel, at the end of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ. This is what I want to come to. Then your hearts became hard after these events. فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ. Then they became like boulders, like rock. أَوْ أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةِ. Or even harder than rock. Now rock is a natural creation of Allah. But when Allah says, أَوْ أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةِ, or even harder than rock, that's important to note, because now they became unnaturally hard. Because then Allah goes back to the analogy of rock and says, وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْحِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَتَفَجَّرُ مِنْهُ الْأَنْهَارُ. From among the stones there are those who rip open, and water comes out from them. Just like Musa alayhi salam struck the staff, and the water came out. So He gave a pertinent analogy, something they had experienced already, that even rock, water comes out of it. وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَشَّقَّقْ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءِ. And some ulama say that this part of the ayah is referring to a part of the history of Bani Israel that is not mentioned in the Quran, but you find it in the Torah. It is that when Musa alayhi salam was taking them in the desert, and he had commanded them to fight. Not only did they were not going to fight, some of them conspired, this guy is crazy, let's go get and kill him. So when they tried to go and kill him, the mountain underneath they were standing started crumbling, and those who had attempted or plotted to kill him among the Bani Israel, they got crushed, and then all of them, the rest of them made tawbah. So the next part of it is, وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَشَّقَّقُ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءِ. Then from among them are those who split open and water comes out from them. وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا مِنَّا لَمَا يَهْبِطُ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. And then from among them are those that they fall, the rocks start falling down from the fear of Allah. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah is not aware, unaware of what you're doing. Last couple of things I'll mention about these people. Because Allah gives that old, old history and then brings it back to the contemporary time of the life of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ. Do you really think these people are going to accept what you're saying, O Muhammad, or O companions? Do you really think they're going to accept what you're saying? وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. Listen to this carefully. And there was already a group from among them that used to engage in the listening of the word of Allah. ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوهُ. Then they deliberately changed it after they understood it. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. And they knew what they were doing. You have the word of Allah. You change it because you don't think it's really the word of God. Something else. But Allah says they heard the kalam of Allah. And in Imam Qurtubi, Imam Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, both of them agree in this tafsir that there was a group from among the companions of Musa who went up, alayhi salam, to the mountain to listen to Allah. They had requested that Allah accepted their request. And they actually heard the statements of Allah. And when Musa, alayhi salam, came back down and advised the people, these were the same people that said, no, Allah didn't say that, you heard wrong. And they tried to correct Musa, alayhi salam. ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُهُ. Then they changed it after they had come to an understanding of it. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. And they knew what they were doing. They had every knowledge of what they were doing. Why am I telling you all of this? These are extreme examples in the Qur'an. But again, we have to relate all of these matters to ourselves. I go to a Muslim brother who's, you know, missing his salah. You know, he doesn't come to the MSA, he doesn't feel like it's an important thing, etc., etc. And I go and talk to him because I'm Pakistani, I can talk to the Pakistanis much easier, right? So I go talk to him in Urdu and I'm chilling with him and I tell him, yaar, chilo namaz padha karo kubhi kubhi, right? So you should pray sometimes. He says, yeah, well, you know. Why don't you pray? I don't know. Do you know that it's fard? Yeah, I know. You understand that fard means you have to do it because your master, your Lord said you have to do it? Yeah, I know. You realize that if you don't pray your fard, you're going to get punished? Yeah, I know that. How come you don't pray? I don't know. I'm good. There's nothing wrong here because after interrogation, you're clear. He understands exactly what to do. Where's the problem? The heart isn't convinced. The heart is a little bit hard with other desires, right? The essential disease described of Bani Israel at the end is their hearts had become hard. And the warning Allah gave, you see the Qur'an has a progression. The Qur'an gives you the stories of those of old, negative and positive. There are role models from the past and there are things, pitfalls not to fall into from the past. But then he gives you a universal guideline and then he gives you the contemporary example. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Hadid, for example, says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Is it not yet time for the believers that their hearts may tremble, they may become conscious, fearful from the remembrance of Allah. وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. And from what has been revealed from the truth, the Qur'an itself. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. And they should not become like the people of the book that were given the book before. Who are the people mentioned? Bani Israel. And the Nasara, the Jews and the Christians, right? فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدِ. A long period passed over them since the legacy was given to them of the faith. Then what Allah describes, the deterioration that took place, فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدِ, the words used are, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ, فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ rather. Then their hearts became hard. وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ, and most of them are corrupt. You find this ayah in Surah Hadid. So now what the warning Allah gives to the believers is, let your hearts not become hard like those before you. When over time, as the messenger was generations before, the more time that passed, the harder their hearts became. And most of them are engaged in corruption. Now I want to give you one positive example before, you know, or actually a couple of positive examples. What happens to someone who really has knowledge? In this society, in Western society, the more knowledge you have, the more status you have, the more recognition you have. Even within the Muslim subculture, within the American community, if you're a sheikh or you've got a degree from somewhere, you know, et cetera, you have a certain title. You have a certain honor and respect among people, right? So your level kind of rises. And even if you're somebody who doesn't know much like myself, but people think you know a lot of stuff, right? And then somebody comes and questions what you're saying or somebody corrects you, you feel like, who's he to correct me? I'm up here, he's down there. So what does knowledge do? Necessarily, if knowledge is not attached with taqwa, knowledge becomes a means of arrogance. Knowledge becomes a means of arrogance. But knowledge attached with taqwa, you know what it does? It humbles you even more. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the people of knowledge. And the reason I'm mentioning this before I go to the Sahaba is, all of you are MSA students, in whatever capacity you're trying to seek knowledge of Islam. And check yourself, and I'll check myself. Before we knew whatever we know now, we don't know a lot, right? But whatever little we know, before we knew that, we didn't used to argue. And once we learned a couple of things, then it became that what we know is the absolute truth, and what the others know is obviously wrong. How could they follow it? They're so utterly ridiculous for following what they're following. So what happened was knowledge became a means of disagreement. Exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in the Quran, time and time and time again. وَمَا تَفَرَّقُوا إِلَّا مِن بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. They did not differ among each other. This ayah is repeated several times. For example, in Surah Shura, in Surah Baqarah itself, in Surah Al-Imran. They didn't differ amongst each other until after knowledge came upon them, baghyan, as a means of being the dominant one, winning the argument among themselves. This became their state. So knowledge became a means of arrogance. But the people of real knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes almost at the end of Surah Bani Israel, Surah Al-Isra, where he says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ إِذَا يُطْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ يَخِرُّونَ لِلْأَذْقَانِ سُجَّدًا. The people of true knowledge, the ones who have been given real knowledge, when the ayat of Allah are recited upon them, then they fall on their faces in sajda. Meaning it humbles them. Their initial reaction in the next ayah describes that they're falling in sajda and they're in tears. Knowledge is not something that brings you to tear unless you're a person of true knowledge. Which means what? You have a lot of stuff in here, you memorized a lot of ayat, you know a lot of tafsir, you know a lot of sahabi's names and all that stuff, right? But your heart is full of the knowledge of the deen, which is a whole different matter. This has very little to do with knowledge as we understand it, academic stuff. This is a whole other field, it's a whole other ballgame. So now when the knowledge was here, it led them to cry. Knowledge here, you can read a chapter or two from any tafsir, it's not going to make you cry. But the knowledge here, when the people of true knowledge, when they heard the ayat, their hearts were the ones that forced them to cry and fall into sajda, to say, وَيَقُولُونَ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّنَا إِنْ كَانَ وَعْدُ رَبِّنَا لَمَفْعُولًا. Having said this, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha is cooking her meal in her home. She sees from the far, in the window, she sees Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming towards her. And as he's walking towards her, revelation comes down about the ayat on hijab from Surah Ahzab. And he's reciting them as they're being revealed to him. And now she's looking at him. So the ayat of hijab have not yet been revealed, so she doesn't know, she's not covered. And she's got her apron on, she's cooking. As she's listening to the ayat, you know what happens? She tears off her apron and covers her head. As she's listening to the ayat, she does this. How amazing is that? There were sahaba who heard, they were alcoholics. Literally, they were alcoholics because it wasn't haram. There's nothing wrong to say that they were alcoholics before it became haram. So they were drinking, they were heavy drinkers. The ayat they heard as they were engaged in their drink. Most of us, if we found out, good believers, we just spit it out, right? You know what they did? They gagged themselves until they threw up everything. And then they went to the Prophet ﷺ crying, saying, Ya Rasulullah, there's still some inside. What do we do? And Allah, the Messenger of Allah said, that's forgiven on you. They were that concerned. Imagine that. There were sahaba, and I'll give you this, you'll find this a crude example, but it should be shared because these are our role models. There were sahaba that were in the battlefield, many, many months away from their wives. And they had desire towards the opposite gender. And they didn't know what to do because, you know, you're out on duty. So either you engage in haram, or you know what to do. So they wrote a letter to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, Ya Rasulullah, if you allow us, we'll cut off our body part. Because we will stay away from fitna. anything that got in their way of obeying Allah, they were willing to sacrifice, even if it was themselves. Imagine that. That's incredible. It really is. The same way, I give you so many examples of what the Sahaba did, and you're like, wow, that's just amazing. You know, there was no time for questioning or asking. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they understood the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah gives the example, you know, with Musa alayhi salam, the Bani Israel used to ask, you know, I'm going to tell you a little bit of the story because I don't have limited time and I have a lot to cover. What happens is there's a murder. And the Bani Israel get framed for the murder by some other guy from the outside. And he says, if you don't find me the murderer, I'm going to kill all of you. He brings his gang with him. So they feel the need to solve this murder mystery. So they go to Musa alayhi salam. Otherwise, they had no concern for who murdered or what happened, right? So they go to Musa alayhi salam, say, solve this problem for us, only you can. So he says, Allah commands you, أَن تَذْبَحُوا بَقَرَةً, that you slaughter a cow. So he said, قَالُوا أَتَتَّخِذُنَا هُزُوًا, you think of us as a joke? Are you making a joke out of us? We're telling you to solve a murder mystery, you're telling us to slaughter cows? What's wrong with you, right? Then he says, قَالَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ أَنْ أَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ, I seek the refuge of Allah that I may be among those who speak with emotion, who speak without knowledge, who speak out of ignorance. So this was a command from Allah that when you slaughter the cow, you take the piece of meat of it, you strike it upon the dead body, and it will rise. Now how did Musa alayhi salam talk to Allah, do you know? He used to go up on the mountain. It was a day's journey from where they were. So the first question they asked, they're like, hey, if we're going to play with this guy, let's play with him some more. So they said, you know, this cow is confusing, come on, can you explain what it is? So he goes on a day's journey to ask Allah. Allah explains, he comes back, قَالَ إِنَّهُ يَقُولُ إِنَّهَا بَقَرَةٌ لَا فَارِضٌ وَلَا بِكْرَ عَوَانٌ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ, right? It's not too heavy, it's not too light, it's not too old, it's not too young, it's just in between. فَافْعَلُوا مَا تُؤْمَرُونَ, then do without thinking what you've been commanded. Not وَعْلَمُوا, not فَعْلَمُوا, فَافْعَلُوا. فَافْعَلُوا is just immediately act. Stop asking questions, just do it, what you have been commanded. But they're like, no, we're not done asking more questions. So they ask more, what color should it be? He goes another day's journey, comes another day back. He comes back again, oh, إِنَّ الْبَقَرَةَ تَشَابَهَ عَلَيْنَا, it's still too confusing for us, go again and ask again, right? So they tortured, this is why in Surah Saf, Musa alayhi salam said, لِمَ تُؤْذُونَنِي, why do you torture me? Why do you hurt me? وَقَدْ تَعْلَمُونَ, and you already know that I'm the messenger of Allah among you. And related to this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that Allah likes for you three things and Allah dislikes for you three things. فَيَرْضَى لَكُمْ, and He likes for you. You know, I'll tell you the part He doesn't like, pertinent to this matter. One of the things that He doesn't like is كَثْرَةُ السُّؤَالِ, too many questions. Take the instruction, act on it. Aisha radiallahu anha didn't find the specifics of what exactly does jalbab mean, or what does covering the head mean, or what color should the khimar be, or what material can it be, and what, you know, what's the fiqh of the matter, etc., etc. She heard it, boom. Whatever the proper understanding of it is, the Prophet ﷺ will explain, but she's already responsible to obey Allah from what she's heard. So she had to act according to what she knew. She had to do that much. Same thing exactly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes about the Sahaba. They didn't know that they could approach their wives during the nights of the fast. They didn't know, because the Jews were not allowed to do it. Right? They were not allowed to approach their wives intimately. So they went and approached their wives, thinking that Allah has not allowed it. Some Sahaba made that mistake. So Allah says, عَلِمَ اللَّهُ أَنَّكُمْ تَخْتَانُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ, Allah knew that you were being dishonest to yourselves. Even Allah knew that it's not haram, but you were still being dishonest because within your limited understanding, you thought it was haram, right? So taqwa has a huge role to play in our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And taqwa lies in the heart, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith of Musnad Ahmad, at-taqwa hahuna, at-taqwa hahuna, at-taqwa hahuna. Taqwa is here, taqwa is here, taqwa is here. The fear of Allah lies here in the heart. So, and the consciousness of Allah rather. So that's the example generally of Sahaba. But I want to give you an example of a youth in particular. This man used to dress the nicest, he used to look the nicest. By the Mushrikun standard, if there was a GQ magazine then, he'd be on the cover, right? He used to get all imported clothes. His shoes used to come from Yemen. That's like saying he, you know, wore Giorgio Armani suits. Or I don't know who the top designer is. They all look retarded to me, but anyway. So he wore really nice clothes and imported perfume, and, you know, Mus'ab bin Umayr radiallahu anhu, before he became Muslim. Very, very smart man, very handsome man. Many women wanted to marry him. Young guy, very smart, very intellectual. So even the chieftains were very proud that they have this man, this pride of their town in Mecca, in their household. He heard that the Muslims are being persecuted. I was curious about what this Muhammad is saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let me go find out. So he goes and sneaks into Darul Arqam to find out. He listens to a khutbah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he's conducting a halaqah with the Sahaba, and he says, this is what my heart had been saying all along. He accepts. He says, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. He makes salah with them. Now he starts coming to the halaqahs regularly, secretly. He doesn't want people to find out, because to find out in Makkah would be a big problem. Especially with his mother, Khunnas bint Malik. His mother was a very powerful woman. She had a very controlling personality. He wasn't afraid of anybody else except his mother. Didn't want to mess with his mom, like many of us. Right? You can take on anybody, but you can't get on mom's bad side. So he's sneaking in, and one of the kuffar, he saw him, and word spread and finally got to his mother. So they called a town meeting from his tribe. They pulled him in. They said, is this true? You become a Muslim? Somebody seen you pray like Muhammad prays. And we saw you go into Darul Arqam. What's going on? He said, yes, I become Muslim. What can I say? He accepted. He acknowledged. His mother's first reaction was to try to spear him. She was that mad. Then to hit him, but she couldn't do it. She loved him too much. So what she decided to do was she tied him up and she put him in the corner of the house with guards watching him the whole day. For days. Many, many days. He stayed in his house, just not even being able to scratch himself, just tied up. Because he had accepted Islam. Then some news came, he heard from outside, or some of the guards were talking, that some Muslims are fleeing to Abyssinia, to Habasha. He heard about it. The next chance he got, when the guards weren't paying attention or sleeping, he escaped. And he went with them to Habasha. He left his family. He comes back, and then he went back again. But eventually when he did come back, his mother caught him again. And she said, you better leave this Islam business, otherwise I'm going to tie you up again. He goes, you can do it, but whoever you hire to tie me up this time, I will kill them. And she knew he meant it, so she didn't try it again. But then the least thing she could do, you know what she said to him? She said, you know what, this wealth you enjoy, these clothes you're wearing, these brand name and these imported shoes and imported perfumes and thobes and everything, this is not yours, this is from my wealth. Her exact words were, I can no longer be a mother to you, so leave this wealth. He's leaving his house, his uncle stops him. He says, you know these clothes you're wearing right now, they're from your uncle. They're from your father, your late father. So they don't belong to you either. Take them off if you want to stay with Islam. He, the man who everybody looked to for fashion standards, the guy who was like, the most handsome man, the most respected young man in the society, had to leave his house covering his shame with his hands. He had to leave his house naked. This is the state of Mus'ab bin Umair, radiallahu anhu. Comes to Rasulullah, gets some garb to wear. And now he starts, and totally commits himself to the task of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, learning the Qur'an constantly. He's sitting with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, learning and memorizing the Qur'an. And he was one of the most beautiful reciters of the Qur'an. So now the six people come from Medina, and the Prophet has to send sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a helper to go teach the deen. He has many choices. There are seniors like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Umar bin Khattab, right? Why does he choose Mus'ab? He's young, he's already shown his will to sacrifice, and he's a beautiful reciter, so he can bring people with his charm of recitation, even, to the deen. So the Rasulullah sent Mus'ab bin Umair to Medina. He goes to Medina, he's living with somebody else as a guest, and he starts going every single day, next neighbor's house, this one's house, that one's house, reciting Quran to them, bringing them to Islam, slowly but surely. And people, if they didn't come to Islam, they were mesmerized by the Qur'an, so they would come and sit in his gatherings, which bothered the chiefs of the tribes. One of the chiefs heard about this, he got really mad. One day Mus'ab was sitting outside in public giving the dars, teaching Qur'an, and he came with a spear and said, you better stop talking to my tribe or I will kill you. And Mus'ab, young man, if anybody else comes up to us, you're holding an MSA meeting, some guy walks in here, you Muslims better stop this or I'm gonna take care of you outside in the parking lot. Right? Oh, he's like, oh yeah, bring it on. This is what we would do. You know what he says, Mus'ab bin Umair? He looks at this guy threatening him, and he says, well, why don't you listen to what I have to say? If you accept it, well and good. If you reject it, I'll stop bothering you. Which just sounds fair. Put his spear, stuck it in the ground, he sat down, and Mus'ab bin Umair started reciting the Quran, very calmly. And the man heard it, and he said, this is the truth. How can I enter this religion? And he became a Muslim. And then he said, oh, wait a second. I know a man, if he accepts, then his whole tribe will accept. Let me get him for you. And he went and got him too. And before this happened, incidentally, this was the chief of a tribe, right? He comes to Mus'ab bin Umair and said, what can I do to enter this religion? Mus'ab says, you have to go take a shower first and wear clean clothes. Then come back. So he goes, takes a shower, comes back, and then Mus'ab ibn Umair takes shahada from him, and then from the other tribes, and huge chunks, you know, of Medinan tribes start coming into Islam. So Mus'ab ibn Umair was the trendsetter for history. What we have now, what the Rasul ﷺ had as a refuge in Medina, was the work of Allah through Mus'ab ibn Umair. This youth who decided to give up his wealth. In Medina, when the Prophet came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time he was giving a khutbah, a dars, and Mus'ab ibn Umair came and sat in the majlis. And a lot of people looked at him from Makkah, the ones that knew him. They looked at him and they looked down like this in shame. And a lot of them started crying. You know why? Because he was wearing a torn blanket. This was the man they remembered wearing brand name clothes, and, you know, amazingly dressed. Nobody dressed as good as he did. Now he's wearing all of this only because he decides he's going to sacrifice all of his preferences for the sake of Allah. So some Sahaba even started crying. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even looked at him and said, I remember you used to be very, very well dressed. Your family used to dress you well. They used to feed you well. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised and actually congratulated the believers that Allah will give them kingship of when they will have different clothes to wear in the day and different clothes to wear in the night. And the Sahaba said, will we be better off then? And the Prophet said, no, you're better off now. You're better off right now when you don't have anything. Because then the love of dunya, what the Prophet meant, the love of dunya will enter into your hearts. In any case, Mus'ab ibn Umair, at the Battle of Badr, his brother is captivated. He's one of the prisoners with the Muslims. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, take good care of the prisoners. So his brother is prisoner, and the Sahaba, they're eating food, they're eating rice, and they're drinking water, and they're giving the same amount of rice and water to him. Mus'ab ibn Umair walks by, and he looks at his brother, and he says to the guard, my brother, tie this kafir up tightly, because his mother is rich, she'll probably give a good ransom to us. And his brother looks at him like, you're not talking to him, are you? You're talking to me, right? He goes, no, you're not my brother, that's my brother. His iman was such that he understood, just like Nuh alayhi salam was made to understand, those who are not in the boat are not your family. Those who fight against this deen, they're not your family. Those who believe with you, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَنُدْخِلَنَّهُمْ فِي الصَّالِحِينَ in Surah Al-Kabut. Those who have iman and engage in righteous deeds, we will enter them into a new affiliation, a new family of the righteous. لَنُدْخِلَنَّهُمْ You've been indoctrinated into a new family. Those who struggle with you in the way of this deen. So this was the character of Mus'ab ibn Umair. But I haven't gotten to the real part yet. What, how Allah honored him. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him. In the Battle of Uhud, we know some Sahaba, and I'll say this, and please understand it carefully, made an unconscious mistake. It wasn't a conscious disobedience of Rasulullah, but it was a misunderstanding at the hands of the Sahaba. So they came down from their positions, you know the famous incident, right? Now what happened was the mushrikun, their target was to assassinate Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So their attack coming down from the hill was targeted towards Rasulullah. Mus'ab ibn Umair was a smart man. He understood this. And he was the flag bearer. So he grabs the flag, stands apart in the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so to direct traffic towards him, and starts screaming takbir. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Why? So the people who are going to assassinate him would get their direction, attention towards him first. So people start coming towards him and attacking him. A horseman comes by, chops off his arm, his right arm, from here. He was holding the flag in the right arm. He grabs it in the left arm. And as he grabs it, he knows. Why is he doing this? His love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he's willing to let go, right? Of everything, of his own life. So he says, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ Muhammad is nothing except a messenger. Messengers passed before him too. So even though I'm doing this for the sake of Muhammad, in the end I'm doing this for Allah. He knew this, he clarified this to himself, even though he knew it was hurting him that the attack to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is becoming more and more opened up. So he kept reminding himself, screaming as his arm is chopped off, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ The kuffar came and they chopped off the other side. Now whatever he has left of his arms, he's holding the flag like this, screaming, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرَّسُولِ They came and they speared him and he died in that state. And then afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored what was in his heart, and he put this ayah in Surah Ali Imran. In the description of the Battle of Uhud, you find this ayah, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرَّسُولِ Muhammad is nothing except a messenger. Messengers came before him too. Afa imata, if in case he died, aw qutila, or if he got killed, and qalabtum ala aqabikum, are you going to turn back on your heels? فَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ, the one who turns back on his heels, فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا, he could not harm Allah in anything. وَسَيَجْزِ اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ, and Allah will soon reward the shakirin, those who are grateful. When Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at the body of Umayr, you know, the shuhada were being given salams on the battlefield. These young men were being given salams by the because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had instructed us, even to this day, that we're supposed to say salam on the shuhada. For they respond to the salams according to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the sahaba that survived the battle, they're going around giving salams to the shuhada. They got to the body of Mus'ab ibn Umair and all of them started crying. And when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw his body, you know what he said? He said, فَمِنْهُمْ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُ اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ. They are from, this is an ayah of the Quran that he recited when he looked at him. You know, we can recite these ayahs. But when these ayahs were recited by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was something else. He said, from among the believers are real men that have already confirmed their covenant that was made with them, that Allah had made with them. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ, then from among them are those who have given their due already. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ, and from among them are those who are still waiting to give their due. وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا, and they would not replace their desire to give their due, to give their whole life to Allah, with anything else. They would not replace it for anything. This is the ayah Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited upon the body of Mus'ab ibn Umair. As he lay, you know one of the reasons the Sahaba were crying? His cloth was so little that if you covered his head, his feet would show. And if you covered his feet, his head would show. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when you bury him, cover his head and cover his feet with grass. That's how he was buried. This was Mus'ab ibn Umair, that rich, wealthy man. Why am I sharing this example with you? We're not in the battlefield, we're not, you know, we don't have to travel to from New York to Habasha or Medina, right, to get away from persecution. But we have a mission, and it's the same mission as that of the companions. If somebody comes and says to you, no, 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 the companions, their lives are not relevant to ours, because that was then, that's a historical context. We need to understand it, but we need to reinterpret all of these values in Islam. This is all garbage. It's garbage because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself has given them the certificate. رَضِيَ anhum wa radu anhu. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. You want to be pleased with them? You want to be pleased with Allah? And you want Allah to be pleased with you? You gotta follow their model. How many times in the Quran, Muhammadun Rasulullah, in Surah Fath in particular, وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ, and those who are with him. Allah honors the Sahaba. He honors the Sahaba in particular, like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq in the Quran, he honors him, calling him Thani Athnain in Surah Tawbah. Like he mentions a nickname for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. But for others, he mentions them in plural, in general. And he gives them so many honors in the Quran that we can't take away from them and say, no, 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 this is just some intellectual discourse on the side. It has no relevance to how we behave. In this regard, I wanted to share with you the last ayah which I recited in the beginning of Surah Al-Fath. Muhammadur Rasulullah, and there are linguistic differences of opinion on this ayah, but the more dominant opinion, which is consistent with the theme in the ayah, is if you know some Arabic, Muhammad Mubtada Rasulullah Khabar. But that's the not the dominant opinion. The dominant opinion is Muhammadur Rasulullah is ism wa na'at ism, or mawsoof and sifa, right? It's an adjective. Muhammad, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ, and those who accompany him, those who are with him, أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ, they are intense against the kuffar. They are severe against the kuffar. This ayah is so easy to read now because you could call Bush a kafir or this one a kafir or that one a kafir and you're harsh towards them. But you know what? With the Sahaba, their mother was a kafir. For many of them, their brother was a kafir. Their father was a kafir. Their own son was a kafir. How could you read this ayah and think of your own son to be harsh towards him? To be willing to kill him on the battlefield? What kind of iman does that take? Read Surah Mujadala, read the end on your own. Read the end of Surah Mujadala. La tajidu qawman, you will never find a nation, yu'minuna billahi, that truly believes in Allah, yu'aduna man haddallahu rasulah, mutually engaging in a loving relationship with anyone who intentionally resists Allah and His Messenger. Walau kanu aba'uhum aw abna'uhum. Even if they're their fathers or their sons, and the ayah goes on, if they're their brothers, their relatives. What is this? The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took over everything else. Everything else. All their other relationships were defined by who Allah loves. In this regard, and again, I'm going to share the last ayah of Surah Fath, the next part of it, but before I do, I want to share a hadith with you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah, Allah fi ashabi. Fear Allah in the matter of my sahaba. لا تتخذوهم عرضا. Don't take them in a matter of disagreeing among you or arguing among you or criticizing them or saying, this sahabi made a mistake, this sahabi said this, this sahabi said that. Be careful of when you speak of them. من بعد, after I'm gone. فمن أحبهم فبحبي أحبهم. Whoever loved them, then he loved them out of my love. ومن أبغضهم فببغضي أبغضهم. And whoever hated them, criticized them, then out of my hatred, out of my criticism, he criticized them. He was criticizing me. What is the product of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? His product is the human beings that he generated. These characters that he produced. What is the product of the Qur'an? The product of the Qur'an is these sahaba. These role models that in the beginning of Surah, in Surah Baqarah, the munafiqun are being told, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ النَّاسِ. Why don't you believe like these people believe? Look at their iman. Believe like them, because these were what the Qur'an had produced. And this is why I wanted to share this ayah with you. But I want to finish the hadith. This is in An Tirmidhi, and this is related by Abdullah bin Al-Maghfir. The Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَنْ أَذَاهُمْ فَقَدْ أَذَانِي. The one who hurt them, then he has hurt me. وَمَنْ أَذَانِي فَقَدْ أَذَى اللَّهِ. The one who has hurt me, he has attempted to hurt Allah. وَمَنْ أَذَى اللَّهِ فَيُوشَكُ أَنْ يَأْخُذَهُ. And whoever attempts to hurt Allah, I fear that he will be seized by Allah. Allah will seize him into the punishment. This is the honor the Prophet ﷺ gave to the Sahaba. Now this is the hadith. Now listen to the ayah. وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ. And those who are with him. Who are they? They're the Sahaba. Mentioned in the Quran. أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارُ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ. They are intense against the kuffar. They are excessively merciful among themselves. You find the tafsir of this in Surah Ma'idah. Al-Qur'an yufassiru ba'dahu ba'da. Qur'an explains one part of it with another part. So there Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَذِلَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. They are أَذِلَّةٍ. أَذِلَّةٍ in the Qur'an is used in negative terminology and positive terminology. Negatively speaking, it refers to humiliated. No self-esteem. And أَذِلَّةٍ positively means so soft that you forget your own ego for the sake of the one you're engaged with. And this is the meaning here in Surah Ma'idah. That they are so humble, so soft towards the believers. You want to take role models of what Allah describes about those who are with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first characteristic. They are intense against the kuffar. They are excessively merciful among themselves. And the meaning of excessively merciful is adhillatin ala al-mu'mineen. Extremely humble. Somebody's arguing with you, smile. Somebody's criticizing you, thank him. Maybe he did you a favor. Somebody spoke behind your back, ask Allah to forgive him instead of approaching him and say, you talk behind my back, man? No, don't even go to him. Go to Allah and ask him to forgive. Ask Allah to forgive that person. Make dua for the people who have hurt you, not in their presence, in their absence, on your own. This is, you've forgot yourself. أَذِلَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. They are strong. They are uncompromising. They seem to show no fluctuation when it comes to the kafirin. Here I want to pause for a moment because I need to clarify what kafirin means. Because I know there's going to be a question. So does that mean we have to be like, when I sit next to my class, I go, argh. My classmate, and the Muslim brother, I you know. No, it's not like that. Al-kafir in the Quran is a very important term to understand. First of all, terms in the Quran are not universal. Meaning one term can mean different things in different places in the Quran depending on the context. Kafir in the Quran also means farmer. In an analogy, kafir means one who buries, literally, kafir is the one who buries the seed, the light of iman. But kafir in Arabic terminology refers to a farmer, and that's been used in the Quran also. But here, kafirin, and in Surah Baqarah, just to explain this matter to you, usually you find disbeliever. And in English, when you think disbeliever, you think someone who doesn't believe in Islam. So it must be everybody else who's not a Muslim is, by definition, a kafir. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and you probably know this ayah, beginning of Surah Baqarah, سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. It's the same upon them. If you warn them or you don't warn them, they're not going to believe. If that's the case, then is there any point to give da'wah to anybody? If the Prophet is being told, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if you warn them or you don't warn them, they're not going to believe. And if kafir refers to everybody, then why is the Prophet calling to anybody? Because Allah said they're not going to believe. It doesn't matter if you call them or not. So kafir is not the rest of mankind who doesn't believe in Islam. Kafir is specifically, by virtue of, this is a detailed study in and of itself, but make it on your own inshallah, those upon whom the case of Islam had been established. They knew that this is in fact the word of Allah. They had no other place to go. Like Allah Himself says, فَأَنَّا يُؤْفَكُونَ كَهَا جَعْرَيُوا. Where are you going? Where do you have left to go? You've got nowhere to go. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Why don't you think now? These are the people who, after having no more excuses to go anywhere else, still out of their arrogance reject. Still out of their pride or out of their desires or out of their laziness, whatever it may be, they reject. These are the kafirun. And the only other category of kafirun that is definitive is the one who picks up a sword against the Muslim. If somebody picks up a sword against the Muslim, picks up arms against the Muslim, whether he was given da'wah or not, he becomes automatically under the category of kafirun. So we must be stern towards them. Somebody's running with you with a gun and you say, no, we have to give him da'wah, we have to be soft. No. Not then. And you gotta be a'izzatin ala al-kafirin. You follow? But mushrikeen are different, because in Surah Tawbah, which is the surah of no mercy for the kuffar, even in that surah Allah says, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ. If any one of the mushrikeen come to you trying to find out what this Islam is, give them space, let them find out. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. Until they hear the word speech of Allah. ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَ. Then let them reach a safe place, let them think about it on their own. Let them make the decision themselves. So there is a distinction, and there's the danger in just reading a translation is this, that we come to conclusions that aren't accurate, even in light of the Quran itself. So in any case, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا. I'm sorry, I need to go off on one more tangent. Surah Hujurat, which is the next surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a character of the Sahaba. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. Allah has made iman beloved to you, and He has beautified it in your hearts. He has beautified iman in your hearts. وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمْ. And He has made disgusting to you الْكُفْرُ وَالْفُسُوقُ وَالْعِصْيَانُ. Disbelief, rejection, corruption, and disobedience to Allah. He has made those disgusting to you. So the true believer is one, when he sees haram, he doesn't say, astaghfirullah, I really want to do it, but I'm not going to do it. He says, astaghfirullah, I'm been sent by Allah to get rid of this. He hates it. He's not tempted anymore. That's when you've reached iman. When you're not tempted by evil, you're actually disgusted by it. That's iman. حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ. Iman has been made beloved, not kufr and fusuq and isyan. That's what's been made disgusting to you. And part of the manifestation of these two ayat together, you see, iman has been made beloved, and the believers who have iman have been made beloved. Kufr has been made hated, and those who stick on kufr have been made hated also. Notice what happens to you. I'm going to give you a lay example. You're on your way. All of us are on this journey to iman. We don't have perfect iman. But you know, for the men here, and you're all men, I'm not going to say boys or guys, you're men. Before you turned to the deen and you were partying in high school or whatever, right? You don't have to tell me, I know. Maybe you were attracted to some non-Muslim women, or you know, the way they dressed in the kafir way, in the fahsha way. But when you started turning to Allah's deen, you know what happened? They look ugly. And the sisters that are covered, and wearing hijab, and you don't see anything, they're the most beautiful thing you ever seen. Like, how did that happen? Allah beautifies iman. They don't see any beauty in it. You say, what do you get to see, man? Right? But we see beauty in it. We're mesmerized by it. SubhanAllah, she covers. I've never even seen her face. I want to marry her. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put that love of iman in you. So that which Allah has made halal, Allah puts the love of that in you also. This is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are from the character of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in. They hated that which was in disobedience to Allah. They loved that which was in obedience to Allah. I want to give you one analogy. Sahaba would come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What was one of the common questions they would ask? How much should we spend? What was another question? What can I do to get to paradise? How many hadith do you find? What can I do to get to paradise? How can I get away from the hellfire? How can I protect myself from the dajjal? How can I, serve Allah better? Tell me something that will save me. These were the questions. Go on an online forum for young Muslim, you know, students, or go to an ijtihad session. Is chatting halal? Can I eat this? Can I get a mortgage? Can I get... You see a difference in line of questioning? There the questions were, what more can I do for Allah? Now the questions are, what can Allah do for me? What more can He make halal for me? I want to make my life easier, right? How can I build, make this into paradise? The people, the Sahaba were asking, how can I make the next life paradise? There's a difference of a paradigm. I would give a talk on, you know, sacrificing, giving in the way of Allah. At the end I'd get a question, brother, do I really have to have a beard, or is it okay if I shave? Why? Even if I answer that question, it's not the matter that, you know, we shouldn't get into fiqh discussions. But the line of questioning represents something in your heart. You don't ask about something you don't care about. You care about these things. This is what your heart is preoccupied with. Our heart needs to be preoccupied with, how can I get to the Jannah? What more can I do for Allah? What am I doing for Allah? Is that enough? Have I fulfilled my obligations to Allah? What can I do more for da'wah? What is da'wah? How can I embody what was sent, what was given in the Quran as role models for da'wah? How can I better my salah? How can I give more in the way of Allah? What to give? How to give? These were the questions that were asked, because people were concerned with building the next real estate, not here. They were concerned with the paradise. So now Allah describes what they look like. تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا. You will see them. رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا is beautiful Arabic terminology. They're in plural, raki' and sajid, rukka' sujjad, okay? But now they are, this is sifa. Now rukka'an wa sujjadan. Can you be in ruku' and sajda at the same time? It's impossible, right? Allah says rukka'an sujjada. They're in ruku' sajda. You see them in sajda ruku'. He didn't say rukka'an wa sujjadan. That would be you see them in ruku' and you see them in sajda. So what does this ayah mean? These are actually states of being, states of character that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing. You see them bow themselves down, like Allah says to Bani Israel, irka'u ma'ar raki'een, bow yourself down like those who have bowed themselves down. You will find them that in Surah Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the call to the believers, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu irka'u wasjudu wa'budu rabbakum, right? Make ruku', make sajda, and make sajda. You see in salah also, just by your shallow observation, you see that ruku', somebody who doesn't know what prayer is, somebody's humbling himself, right? But sajda, somebody's humbling himself a lot more. So what do you see? You never see them in a state of ghafla. Either you see them humble themselves, or you see them in even more submission. Either they're engaged in Allah's work, or they're really engaged in Allah's work. There's no other thing. قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. Standing, sitting, or on their sides, lying down. All the time they're in the remembrance of Allah. The only matter is what the intensity of it is. But it's all the time. There's no weekends, there's no time off. There's no, like, you know, on Eid we just kind of like laid back after Ramadan, the ibadah is done. It's 3 days of just chilling and partying and PlayStation and whatever else, right? There's none of that, because rukka'an sujjadan. Why? يَبْتَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ. Beautiful ayat. They are seeking energetically. إِبْتَغَى يَبْتَغِي is to seek energetically, enthusiastically. فَضْلًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ. The blessing from Allah. Fadl means, blessing is a weak, you know, English word. Fadl and ajr. Ajr is reward. You know, you make salah, you expect Allah to reward it. Fadl is you're asking Allah to give you something you don't even deserve. Allah, just give. I know I don't deserve. So they're seeking the blessing of Allah. More than what they've done, they're seeking the mercy of Allah. The blessing of Allah. Waridwana, and on top of everything else, they are seeking His contentment. That Allah be pleased with them. This is the ultimate fadl of Allah. You know, this reminds me of the end of Surah Baqarah. I know I'm big on tangents, I'm sorry. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, at the end of Surah Baqarah, we are asked to make dua. فَعْفُ عَنَّا وَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَرْحَمْنَا أَنْتَ مَوْلَانَا فَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. In the Arabic, if probably in an average transition, you'll find, forgive us, and forgive us, or synonyms of forgiving. فَعْفُ عَنَّا وَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَرْحَمْنَا, and show us mercy. So forgive us, and show us mercy. Well, how come, and all three of them have to do with forgiving, right? Showing Allah, showing mercy. How come these three terms are used? فَعْفُ عَنَّا is lovingly overlook our mistakes in this life. When we are doing work for you, O Allah, we will fall short. Keep overlooking those mistakes, lovingly. On the day of judgment, وَغْفِرْ لَنَا, cover our mistakes. غَفُور, the attribute of Allah, is to cover. Right? وَرْحَمْنَا, and show us mercy and enter us into the paradise. You see, on the day of judgment, the believers are described that they are yas'a nuruhum bayna aydihim wa bi aymanihim. There's a light of iman, the real faith coming out from the front, and the light of their good deeds, what they did for the sake of Allah, coming from their right. And they're in the dark, they're walking towards the paradise. But you know what? That's not enough to get them there. Their iman and their good deeds are not enough to get them there. So they say, رَبَّنَا أَتْمِمْ لَنَا نُورَنَا. Oh, our Rabb, complete for us our light. وَرْحَمْنَا إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And show us mercy, you are upon all things powerful. So in the end, you need Allah's light to get you there. This is why when they get to the paradise, they say, Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana lihada. All praise belongs to Allah. All thanks belongs to Allah, who guided us to this paradise. وَمَا كُنَّا لِنَهْتَدِيَ. We could never have guided ourselves. لَوْلَا أَنْ هَدَانَ اللَّهِ. Had it not been Allah who guided us. So these are from the things I'm trying to share with you regarding the Sahaba, is they were conscious of where they're heading. Everything they did had this outlook. You guys are in your careers now, you're in your studies now. Why are you in the study that you're in? Oh, I like it. Well, what is Allah like for you? And you know what? One of the big problems I see personally, it's a Christian disease in my opinion, and it's injected itself into the ummah. I really want to memorize the Quran. I really want to learn tajweed. I really want to learn fiqh. I really want to study tafsir. I. What does Allah want you to do? This question has disappeared almost. What is the need of you? What capabilities do you have? And how can you maximize them to your full potential, even sacrificing what you might want to do? Because that may not be the priority, that may not be the need. The need may be something you don't have an inclination towards, but it's a need. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking of it. I'll give you an example. I hate talking to strangers. Personal example, I hate talking to strangers. I'm sitting in the train, I went to Baruch to do some paperwork, I came back, I'm sitting in the Long Island Railroad, there's a white guy sitting next to me, trench coat, suit, the regular corporate guy, right, rush hour, and 45 minute train ride, I'm sitting next to him, I'm like, well, I really don't want to talk to him, right? Because he was cursing on the phone, et cetera, I was discouraged. But then on the day of judgment, whether I like to or not, Allah will ask me for these 45 minutes. And he was a financial analyst. I could tell he had a Wall Street Journal on him or whatever. So I'm like, what can I talk to him about? I gotta find something. I see like a newspaper on the floor. I think it was the New York Times. Pick it up, open up the financial section. I'm like, oh, I had no idea what financial market is, okay? No idea. Like, man, the market's crazy nowadays. And he's like, yeah, it's just unbelievable. I'm like, yeah, start talking. 45 minutes go by, he shows me the picture of his daughter and how he left Catholicism, and he's searching for the truth, and I invited him to the masjid. He's bringing his whole family, inshallah, in a couple of weeks to come to the masjid. But I didn't want to talk to him. I didn't. What am I trying to tell you? The Sahaba didn't care for what they wanted. Even in the matter of deen, shaitan will come to you and say, do this, you're really good at it. Hey, learn to recite more. Take 20 hours just learning to recite. Forget everything else you got to do for Allah. So in the end, people, mashallah, he recites really, really good. You got to figure out what, you're the slaves, Allah is the master. So what you want to do for Allah is even dictated. This is what I'm trying to convey to you. And this is what the Sahaba understood. This is when they gave their pledge of allegiance to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said, fil usri wal yusr, fil manshat wal makra, fil manshat wal makra. They said, in difficulty and in ease, we will follow you. Whether we're inclined to follow you or we're not inclined to follow you, we will follow you. This was their character. This is what we need to really, really understand. Because see what happened in Christianity and the continuing deterioration in Christianity is you go to church, and the way they invite you to church now is we're going to have a dance party, or we're going to have a festival, or we're going to have a piñata, or we're going to have a balloon sale or whatever. They're going to do all these fun things, right? And people come to church and they feel good about themselves because they had a good workout. They're like doing all kinds of things which make them feel better about themselves. So Christianity, to keep its audience, it's now what it's doing is not what you can do for God, it's what God can do for you. And that mentality at a much lower level at this point, and inshallah it'll disappear, it won't increase, is seeping into the minds of Muslims. What can Islam do for me? Or what can I do according to my inclination, according to what I want to do for Islam? This is one thing we have to be careful of. Because the mandates of the Sahaba were dictated by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, dictated by the Quran. Whether Mus'ab wanted to go to Medina or not, whether he wanted to leave the company of the Prophet or not, I would assume he loved the Prophet so much he didn't want to leave him. But he understood he had to go. So he went. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, now I'll give you this example of the love the Sahaba had for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's sitting with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the mushrikun come and they start cursing Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, cursing his wife, cursing his sister, cursing his mother, all kinds of obscene language. He's sitting there quietly. Sabr. They said, Abu Bakr is not going to move like this. They start cursing Rasulullah and his family sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At this, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq got up, enraged. As soon as he got up, the Prophet walked away sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, forget these people. Why am I wasting time responding to them? Let me go ask why my beloved left. So he ran to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asked him, what's the matter? Why did you leave? He said, so long as you were sitting there, the angels were standing around us saying, Abu Bakr ala al-haq, he's on the truth, he's on the truth, he's on the truth. As soon as you got up, they all flew away. And I don't sit where angels are not in my company. What am I telling, from this example, what am I telling you? Why did Abu Bakr as-Siddiq get up? From what he thought was the appropriate thing to do for Allah's deen, right? But even that was curbed. You don't even decide what to do for Islam other than what the Prophet has instructed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the kind of sabr, this is the kind of perseverance and consistency we need to develop in ourselves, this discipline. I'm not going to name you, you know who you are. Like, so what are you doing for Allah nowadays? Well, here and there on the side. Everything else is on the side. This is what has to be done. Your slavery to Allah has to be established. This, you know, your school's on the side. Oh, but I'm on the side, I work full time. On the side, I'm taking 12 credits. What I'm really doing is I'm serving Allah's deen. This needs to be our prerogative. This is what the Sahaba were like. They weren't just, you know, entertaining speeches, and they weren't just people that we just hear about and we say, oh, they're so great, what can we do? They had laser beam shooting out of their eyes and they were bulletproof and there was no kryptonite at the time. So, you know, it's not like that. They were human beings. They made mistakes too. They made mistakes. And the Prophet ﷺ corrected them. They fell and then they got up and they walked again because they knew they couldn't stop going. They couldn't stop moving towards their journey. So we need to be clear on our resolve. I end this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ. You see the markings on their face from the impact, from the consequence of making sajda. Some sahaba were of the opinion that there's a mark that appears on your forehead from sajda. Some people in later generations, actually, like the Shia, for example, do this as a regular practice, a group from among them, but even from as a sunnah, people did this. Just to become part of this ayah, they would put like pebbles on the musalla, and then when they go to sajda, like give a little rub. So over time, they got a little mark here. It's like, I got a guarantee I'm going to paradise. That's not what's being referred to here. Ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Allahu A'lam, had the, from what I understand, the closest opinion. He said that this is referring to those who reflect the fear of Allah and the love of Allah on their face. And he used this from the hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is reported in Ibn Majah. I'm going to read it directly out of here. مَنْ كَثُرَ صَلَاةً بِاللَّيْلِ حَسُنَ وَجْهَهُ بِالنَّهَارِ. The one who exceeded his salah in qiyam, in the night, that his face becomes beautified during the day. سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ. You will see the markings on their face, you will see the signs on their face from the effects of doing sajda. You will see them as people of sajda. You find, particularly among our youth, brothers and sisters, the more we learn, the more arrogant we get, the more argumentative we get, the harder to deal with we get, the more intimidating we get. But if we are people that are being described, like the Sahaba are being described, then the more we learn, the more the sign of sajda should be on our face. We're humble. We're always ready to be corrected. We're always ready to be, you know, to be criticized. They were ready for it. Again, tangent. Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he's walking, he's Amir al-Mu'mineen, he sees somebody drinking in his house. He's peeking in. He jumps in the house. Breaks in. It grabs him. You're drinking in my rule? You break the Sharia of Islam? And the guy who's drunk, he goes, well, I broke one rule, you broke three. He's like, what do you mean? Well, first of all, you shouldn't be spying. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُ. Right? Second of all, you should knock when you come in. Right? And third of all, you did one. You assumed that I was drinking. I could have been drinking anything. But you assumed from the look of me that I was drinking. Right? اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن. Stay away, for the most part, from dhan, from assumption. Abu Bakr, Umar ibn Khattab, Amir al-Mu'mineen, he hears this, lets him go, walks out. Leaves, doesn't say anything, just leaves. Head of state, open to criticism. A couple of months later, he's giving khutbah, he's giving a dars. And that man walks into the crowd. He sits in the back. Umar ibn Khattab saw him. Khutbah ends, he calls him over. He goes in his ear, you know, I never told anybody about you. And the man goes to Umar ibn Khattab, yeah, and I stopped drinking from that day. But this was the character of the Sahaba. Even the way they corrected people were so beautiful. See, he had his anger, he went out of control, he realized it, and he stopped himself immediately. So the fact is, we will make mistakes, but who of us will acknowledge our mistakes and stop and go back? So now, ذَلِكَ مَثَلُهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ, that such is their example in the Torah. وَمَثَلُهُمْ فِي الْإِنْجِيلِ, and their example in the Injil is كَزَرْعٍ أَخْرَجَ شَطْأَهُ فَآزَرَهُ فَاسْتَغْلَظَ فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ. This analogy is that of a seed planted into the ground by the farmer, and when it comes out, it's just a little tiny, weak little, you know, object, right? It's like a blade. Then it starts strengthening and thickening, and it rises higher and higher, becomes more obvious to others. Before, you don't see it. It's like, you know, something you step on, you don't even realize it. But as it becomes higher and higher, people go around it. And as it becomes more beautified, flowers, and it comes to its full bloom, then it becomes a matter of beauty, particularly for the one who sowed it. If you ever worked on your backyard, I don't think you do, usually older people do that, right? When they plant a seed and they see the plant grow in a month or in a week, they're really proud of that plant. Who is the farmer in this case, in this analogy? It is Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These Sahaba who were, at that time, nobody considered them significant. Nobody knew what their worth was. And even their development was taking place, right? But as the times grew, as difficulties grew, as the winds came, as the hurricanes came, as the storms came, and they kept growing, and they kept moving forward, and they kept moving forward, with their development, يُعْجِبُ الزُّرَّاعِ. The farmer is so, you know, impressed with them. لِيَغِيَّ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ, so that the kuffar, the disbelievers, can be disgusted by them. You see, in the Quran, there is this tamthil and there's mumathal. There's the one that, this analogy of the plant is referring to the companions and to the Prophet ﷺ. But the style of the Quran in a couple of places is, at the end of the analogy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will go back to the actual matter which was being given an example of. So at the end of the ayah, Allah mentions the kuffar directly. Instead of giving another analogy, to make it clear that the previous analogy refers to the Sahaba, refers to Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the ayah begins Muhammad Rasulullah anyway. So now لِيَغِيظَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ, so the kuffar can be disgusted by its growth, by their growth. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْهُمْ, Allah has promised those who truly believe and engage in righteous deeds from among them. This minhum is very important. The Sahaba, we agree, are all among, except for those who the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, identified as munafiqun. Other than those, we assume and we believe that they are all sincere. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps them in check even then. So He says He has promised those who have iman and do righteous deeds from among them, maghfiratan, covering of their mistakes, wa ajran azima, and a huge reward. Ajr would be what they got. Ajran azima, much more than what they ever could imagine. Huge, immense, great reward, great payback. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Now, lastly, inshallah, and I'll stop at this point. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been described in Surah Tahreem, يَوْمَ لَا يُخْزِ اللَّهُ النَّبِيَّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ, on the day when Allah will not humiliate the Prophet and those who believed with him. This is an ayah that should give us a clear understanding of the greatness of the Sahaba. Allah has promised that He will not humiliate those who stood with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The only two ayat revealed on the seventh heaven are the last two ayat of Surah Baqarah. In those ayat, the first entity honored is the Rasul of Allah. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه. But who's the second entity honored in those ayat? والمؤمنون, and those who believed. So the Sahaba have been honored on the seventh heaven in the only two ayat that were revealed there. All the ayat came down on the earth. But this is at the incident of Mi'raj. Those ayat came. And even then the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala were honored. So we need to take them as our role models. We need to study their lives to try to understand the level of commitment and sacrifice that they had. And then seriously try to analyze what was their mission and how did they go about it. What exactly was it? What gave them, you know, was their spirituality a means in and of itself, or an end in and of itself, or was it a means to something? Why were they so committed to Allah? Why were they constantly being told to sacrifice and give up and remember Allah? In the middle of the battlefield, they're being told, angels are with you. In the middle of the discussion of Anfal, there's a discussion, you know, disagreement among the hypocrites are raising this issue, and some, you know, Sahaba who didn't know too much raised the issue, saying, you know, we should get some, you know, booty, more than booty than the Muhajirun are getting. Second ayah of Surah Anfal, innamal mu'minun alladhina idha dhukira Allah wajilat qulubuhum. The true believers are those when Allah is reminded, their hearts tremble. Wa idha tuliyat alayhim ayatu zadatuhum imana. When his ayat are recited, their iman goes up. Wa ala rabbihim yatawakkalun. And upon their Rabb, they put their whole trust. To embody the characters of the Sahaba, we need to become a people of sabr. We need to become a people of commitment. We need to become a people of resolve that we will dedicate our lives to the service of Allah's deen. And everything else must revolve around this work. So inshallah ta'ala, I pray, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He give us the courage and the commitment to follow the legacy of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He forgive our shortcomings as people that are trying to serve Him and make mistakes constantly, that He overlook our mistakes and take the good from what we have done, and that He keep purifying our intentions, and He help us to purify our intentions, so no criticism or no praise gets in the way of us doing the work of Allah, that we only do work for Him and for no one else. If I have said anything incorrect, I ask your apology in advance, and if I have said anything good and true, it is only by the mercy of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sure. If there are any. One at a time, please. Okay.
When the companions wrote to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam,
yeah,
about cutting off their body part, what did the Prophet respond?
He said, fast. He said, basically fast. Do what Allah has prescribed as a solution. I think he said something else too. Yeah, I think it was remarry and fast, or fast.
Can you repeat that hadith about the three best deeds and
the whole hadith? It's the hadith, the nas, the narration is in my notes, so I'll have to give you another time, but I'll give you the text of it from what I memorized. Inna Allaha yarda lakum thalathan wa yakrahu lakum thalatha. Allah is pleased with you with three things, and He dislikes for you three things. فَيَرْضَى لَكُمْ, then He likes for you. And تَعْبُدُوهُ وَلَا تُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا, that you enslave yourself to Him and don't do shirk with Him of anything. وَأَن تَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا, and that you hold on to the rope of Allah altogether. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and that you don't differ among yourselves. فَيَكْرَهُ لَكُمْ, and then He dislikes for you. أَن قِيلَ وَقَالَ, that you communicate, you pass forward that which you heard. Meaning you heard something and you just pass it forward without verification. وَكَثْرَةُ السُّؤَالِ, and asking too many questions. وَإِضَاعَةُ الْمَالِ, and hoarding of wealth for the sake, for the love of wealth. These are the three things that Allah does not like for you. That they don't differ amongst each other, so they remain united. Yeah. Oh wow, really? That's a problem.
Yeah, that was until very recently. But I still didn't really know, besides I think I heard that Imam Ghazali had said it, but I didn't know where else it had been, what the understanding
was. It's fairly clear. It becomes clear from contextual analysis. So you'll find it in tafsir like Imam Nasafi's tafsir, who's a linguistic tafsir, right? It's a classical linguistic tafsir. You find some mention of it in Ibn Kathir's work, in Qurtubi's work. this matter was of more of a technical theological discourse outside of the Quran. Are all non-Muslims kafir? Is everybody going to hell, etc., etc.? And there were like issues raised regarding it. But those matters are clear. We're not talking about people's salvation here. We're talking about who to take as an enemy in this world. That should be clear first and foremost, right? Those have been made very, very clear in the Quran. Like, for example, the ayat that talk about kafirun in the Meccan Quran are late Meccan ayat. Early Meccan ayat are just warning. People do this, people do that, you do this, be warned of the hellfire, and they will be cast into the hellfire, etc., etc. But kuffar as a term and their criticism as a people, specifically of the mushrikun, comes in late Meccan Quran, when they had sent their poets and their poets were defeated, when their intellectuals had said this is not the word of a human being, when there was no way out for them intellectually to go to anywhere else as the truth but Islam. Then what Allah passed as a verdict on them was this issue of kufr, that they are now they're in a state of kufr, right? Secondly, kuffar as a term to fight against and to take as enemy has been used in the ayat that refer to the battles. So you find it in Surah Anfal, you find it in Surah Tawbah, you find it in Surah Ahzab, you find it in Surah Al-Imran, Surah Baqarah also, wherever you have mention of the battles. So you'll find that they have been termed. So that's why I give you two instances. Now the beginning of Surah Baqarah, there's three categories of people, very famous, right? Disbelievers, believers, disbelievers, and hypocrites. The classical hypocrites is the sons of Israel. And the contemporary hypocrites are the people that say they believe, but they don't really believe, right? Both of them know the truth. The Bani Israel know the truth because Allah says, يَعْرِفُونَهُ. They recognize him, that they recognize their own sons. So they know the truth. And the munafiqun know the truth. And knowingly, if they reject, then they become from the kafirun. This is why when Surah Tawbah came down, Umar ibn Khattab's comment regarding Surah Tawbah was, before the surah came, there used to be mu'min, munafiq, and kafir. After the surah came, there's only mu'min and kafir. What did he mean by that? He meant that the munafiqun, Allah has exposed them so much that they shouldn't be under any assumption that they're Muslim. They should be clear now that they're either on this side or the other. Okay. So this is something that has to be, it's a sensitive study, but if you study Quran as a cohesive text by itself, these issues become very, very clear. You probably are familiar with the idea that there are several types of tafsir. Right, there's Tafsir Asbab al-Nuzul, like Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, which is famous for a common audience nowadays. But there's Tafsir al-Rabt bayn al-Ayat. There's Tafsir of the interrelationship between ayat and themes that are presented themselves in different places of the Quran and how to take them comprehensively. And work on them has been done more recently than has been done before, though early work had been done on it. But certain issues weren't a major concern in Muslim civilization like they are now. So even traditional scholars have done more work along these lines more recently than they had done before. So it should be, you know, one of the common, I feel, misnomers is that you should reject any contemporary scholar, what he's saying, because he's a contemporary, you only refer to the classical scholars. Look at the content, not the person speaking. Look at evaluate what they're saying, what their proofs are, how sound their judgment is, and then make your decision instead of just categorizing, well, this guy is from here or he's not, he was born in 17th century, what does he know? And this one was from 3rd century, so he probably knows a lot more. That is true, they did have more classical knowledge, but sciences, particularly Islamic science, also developed over time. And I just want to give you one example of that. The issue of the miracle of the Quran. There were divisions among the scholars of what the miracle of the Quran is. One category of them said that the language of the Quran is a miracle. And they did extensive work on it, like Abu Bakr al-Baqillani, for example, rahimahullah, right? Zamakhshari, rahimahullah, who later became Mu'tazila, but that's a whole other story. These scholars, they did work on every ayah. Like they would say, how come this word is placed before, this word is placed after? How come a synonym wasn't used? How come this was used? So they were, in their approach, they were in a sense atomic. Like they would look at each ayah as a miracle and describe the linguistic features of the ayah. Contemporary work shows how the surahs, how they're paired together, how they're like, there's an order in the Quran which seems random, is actually very schematic. And there's a flow in it. But this is more contemporary work. Work was done on this like, you know, 40, 50, 60 years ago by traditional ulama themselves. But that's still a significant amount of work, which is an area of study that we haven't had not dived into before. So just as a simple response, there are still things being said about the Quran that don't contradict our tradition, but rather enrich it. So that should be kept in mind, inshallah. Open-mindedness is a good thing. Yes. Say that again, please. Wasn't it Badr? Yeah.
Was it the concept of every marriage present until conquest of Mecca? Because you told the brother that.
This is after the conquest of Mecca. No. Why are you going to bring up temporary marriage? You like can of worms? You like cans of worms? Too many questions, please, one at a time. I'm off duty. It's all good. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah accept our gathering for his sake. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep mine and your intentions pure. And may Allah remove any ill feelings we may have towards each other in our hearts. Jazakumullah for inviting me. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.